Oh, what's the music teacher's, what's your name again? I'm sorry. Anyone? Hello?
Sorry, Miss Wallace,
Miss
Deb
Wallace.
Wallace.
Yeah, I'll make
Yes.
sure she at least sees the body of what we talked about and all of that stuff. So again, watching that document to see if we get anybody in there. Copy link. Restricted. Only people with the link can see. Okay, done. One more time in the chat. Okay, I'm dropping it in here again. I'm watching to see if anyone shows up here. The art, gem, and music thingy. There we go. And what I want to do while we're doing that is the first part of this conversation is checking in, just checking in with everybody. All right. And my question there is a couple of things. How's it going, number one? What's working and what are we still working on? And that's about like, what are you happy with right now that's going on between you and your students? And what do you wish was true? What is not quite there yet? Okay, so I just want to check in with everybody, kind of have you like share out what's going on. Maybe start with Mr. Rogers and go from there.
Hey, two things. I put the link in the Google and said I need permission. So like it's saying access is denied right now.
Okay, let me go over here and just make sure I got
Yeah, this is Ms. Chismark. I also need permission.
Yeah, it's weird because it didn't do that yesterday, Kevin.
Yeah, Google's got a whole new thing popping up here that's like a whole new, you know how they will change things. Get link. Hold on, I'll figure it out here. It's not. Let me make sure it's not anyone with the link. There we go. Sorry. Okay, now let's try it again. Share, get link, copy link. Okay, try this one here. Google's got a whole new pop-up window that's like, I don't know what they're doing, but that last one I just dropped in there should have you in there. And no, dang
I
it.
will try that.
Anyone with the link can. I got it, man. Wow, what are they doing?
All right, I got into it
Okay.
with that last link.
I'm hoping the links I got on here don't have this whole situation going on. Share with group.
Yeah, I got into it as well, so it's working now.
Yay.
Yeah, mine just let me in too.
Sorry about that, y'all. Okay, so the first question, how's it going? What's working? And what are we still working on? What do you wish was working? So yeah, Mr. Rogers, want to jump in with that?
I think what is working is like still reaching out to the students, and I still struggle with like when I called some students last week, they were like, "Do we actually have to do your workouts?" Yes, you have to do the workouts. I'm not sending them to you for my health. That's pretty much where I am right now between the students not knowing if they have to do it and communication, I guess.
It's interesting. If we were God and we could make anything happen, what do we wish we could do? Like when they ask that question, obviously they could work out or not work out. You can't verify. I mean, what would you have them do? Send a video of them working out or post workout or, a journal, maybe a workout journal.
I did journals the second set of Blizzard bags that I sent out, and I think I got six back. I even got a couple back that didn't have anything written on them.
Okay, you still work on we need to work on that one. At least you're trying. Are there any kids, Mr. Rogers, that you can't reach that you haven't been able to reach?
Just one, he's an eighth grader. I was supposed to give him a post test. I reached out to his mom twice, and she said he wasn't. Mrs. Mark, you talked to Derek's mom too. She said that he wasn't with her anymore, or something like that.
How about you, Kayla?
Well, first of all, I woke up anxious today because I'm a very anxious person. But I guess with the last group of packets that I had, the first ones that I graded, I was surprised. I had a lot of students actually turn something in that normally don't turn stuff in.
Nice.
So I was really surprised there, and I made some positive phone calls, but I wasn't able to reach any of those students. And then I had a few that said that they turned stuff in and their parents said that they turned stuff in, but packets got mixed up. And I'm hoping when I go to the school today, I can get those few that, you know, got mixed up or whatever. But then I had some kids that didn't turn anything in at all. I tried to reach out and make a phone call to them and couldn't get a hold of them. So. Mm.
Hey, Kayla, kids that are turning things in. You've got, I mean, pictures, right? Things you can see, drawings, stuff like that.
Yeah, I have some drawings that are really, really good.
Okay. So here's what you're probably doing this already, but one of the first things that comes to mind because you have visuals is to open a Google Draw document and make it view only for the kids. Mm-hmm. And then start putting those pictures in there with your comments on the bottom. Oh, I love the way you drew this. I love your shading. The contrast is amazing, blah, 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 blah. So that kids can see that and they can want their stuff in the gallery that you're building, right? That way. Okay. Sometimes I think when kids see that other kids did, maybe they want to do. And I'm thinking the same thing with Mr. Rogers there. How do we create a gallery where we show up like a trophy case? Look at these kids. They're amazing. Look how they hand it in. And so you got to think about how they will hand it in so you can visualize that, whether that's music, whether that's I got this idea right now, and I'm going to share with you guys. I've been doing a coffee house every Sunday, 7 to 9 Central Time. And I got kids who come in here and they show off athletic technique, dance, their art portfolio, their song, their, you know, playing piano or whatever. And I would love it if you'd invite your kids to that. And there's one of those things you can do in the talent show is athletic technique. So a kid could show how to shoot a free throw or anything. So demonstrating basically an ability, you know, that they've worked on. I'm offering that up, and I want to think about that a little bit as we're talking today about how do we create that trophy case. I'm thrilled to hear you're getting work in, Kayla. Mm-hmm. Why do you think that is? And why some students are handing things in that don't usually do anything for you? I mean,
I had some instances, like I think there's just two students that they turned the packet in, they put their name on it, but they didn't do anything on it. But I was still impressed that they turned something in because they normally don't turn anything in at all. They usually lose the work. So, what was your question? I'm sorry.
I was going to ask you, all of you, I've been asking everybody, are there kids that you haven't been able to reach yet? And if so, how many, you know, have not gotten back to you and you don't even know if you're getting through to them? Yesterday it was like 2 for one teacher, 3 for another teacher. The numbers weren't as bad as I thought it could be. But how about you all?
I'm thinking.
I just have one. Sorry. Yeah. Mark.
No, go ahead.
I just have one kid I can't really reach.
I probably have that same kid too, but I probably have a few others added to that as well. So probably about maybe a handful at most.
I was going to ask, yesterday I was talking to teachers about making a list of everyone, all the kids we haven't reached. And so that we could all see that list and we could see, oh, you haven't reached him either. Or, oh my gosh, Dr. Wallace, you did reach them. When you reach them again, can you please send them my note so that we can, like, you know, we could partner that way. Do you guys think it would be valuable to have a list of the kids that have been either hard to reach or impossible to reach?
I think we've been doing that. So our group, I think, has been. It's just been, at least for me, so we have a list of kids that we're assigned to call, but I know some of us, most, I think this group has been calling students that we all have in our different periods of our classes. So, I mean, I think that probably has, at least for me, been helpful to calling students outside of the designated list of students that we call. I think has been helpful with getting students to turn stuff in. I noticed for me, calling students at different times. So I've sort of switched up my time when I call students or certain students. So sometimes I have a better success rate if I catch them in the evening. Some students, if they have my phone number, they'll text me I try not to blow up their text too much because sometimes those students are really touchy about that. So maybe every 2 days I've noticed that if I just send a text message saying, hey, how are you doing? That's a little bit more effective. I think the thing that we do, that we're doing really good at, is just keeping track of who we're calling and when. And so I'm able to go back in the calling log and look to see who's talked to folks. And I think the other thing that we're really doing well is if a student does connect with a teacher, and a teacher that they've been, you know, talking with, you know, the entire week, whatever, and they're having issues with a subject that's outside of that teacher's area, that teacher will reach out to the teacher that assigned that homework and say, hey, make sure you call the student, which has happened. So yeah, I think that's helpful. I don't know, like, I've just been playing with the idea. I've actually not been playing with the idea. I've uploaded the same homeworks to my Google Classroom and tried to make that homework accessible there. So in case they don't miss, in case I don't get homework back, I want to be able to actually get something back, even if it's just one worksheet. So, you know, students are on Google Classroom, but I'm not seeing where they're actually doing the homework. So I've just been messing with just doing videos on how we complete the homework, because normally if we were face-to-face, we would do some of that stuff together in the classroom, and then they would have a time to actually do that stuff, you know, do part of that work on their own. So, but I do think that we're doing a really good job of communicating with one another if we contact a student and we realize that they're having issues in an area that's outside of what we're teaching. So we reach out to that other teacher.
Nice. Listen, we've started putting together a sheet, and I dropped a link in your chat there. This is all written by teachers, you all. And I'd love to have any input that you can have on that document. I also linked it to the Google Doc that I have for you all. I'm going to go ahead and reshare that again, copy that and put it in the chat. This next one I'm dropping in is the support document for us, just you all. And then the one before that takes you to that other page where it's like what works for trying to reach these hard to reach kids. I just want to make sure we're combining all of our strategies that's working. Like you said, Dr. Wallace, different times, you know, calling them at different times. And some people had said like weekends, like, cause usually maybe it's mom's phone. People have expressed a frustration that if they could just get the kid's phone a number, they could reach the kid. But if it's mom, she's working all the time, it's been hard that way. What are some of those sort of trip overs that we've dealt with, like here, you can see on this list on this page here, I got two people in there now, but I'd like to get the rest of you in here. I'm going to drop it in one more time so that you're looking at the same thing as I'm looking at here. Copy link. This last one I'm dropping in here. Boom, boom. There it is. And then they said some people are dropping off, picking up work. Oh, actually literally going there and picking it up from the house. Being available after hours, you know, have kids be able to leave you a message at least. I don't know. Is there anything else that needs to be on that page that's working? And my thinking is, I like that you guys are doing this. One of the frustration people had said, we were sort of randomly assigned certain students to try to reach, and that if we could systematically reach out to the ones we have relationships with, we have a better chance of probably getting through. And you guys have worked on that on your own. And I like that you jumped in, kind of started figuring that out. One of the questions that was on the table I've been asking everybody is, how's it going? What's working? And what, you know, are we still working on? What do you wish was true? So I'm asking everybody in this room here, and so Dr. Wallace, you too, as you know, what's going okay? And what do you wish you could fix?
So I have some things, and please, I it's Dr. Wallace for my student Zoom, and I couldn't change it when I logged in here. I had had issues this morning, so it's Deb, please. So one of the things that I think we've been talking about just as a staff is how we want to approach next year in terms of dealing with student behavior. And we're really having conversations as if we were face to face. And I think there's a gap here because, you know, my intention when I come back next year, is that I want to go paperless. And I want to go paperless for a couple of reasons. One, I'm finding out that students there are some students that are using Google Classroom on a regular basis. But when COVID-19 hit and the schools shut down, the schools across the nation shut down, I noticed two things. One, students who weren't using it. So I know for a fact in my classroom, I wasn't using Google Classroom. And part of that was because of my approach to the area that I'm teaching in. One, it's very hands-on, I'm very practical. I want them to be practical, and not everybody learns that way. Two, because of that, I want to increase muscle memory. But what I found out was that students, even though when we first sent out packets, you know, I'm relying on my own, you know, how I retain information, and these students don't retain information in the same way. I think the other thing too is that there was not a lot of practice, at least from what I saw with the students in my classes, with the use of technology. So I really want to, one, and I think the third thing is I just want to be eco-friendly, and I don't want to fight or get there early or have to stay there late to print out stuff. And so one of the things I've been thinking about is that we need to be talking really hybrid classroom from face-to-face, and we need to be moving that stuff online. So if a kid, whether we come back full-time face-to-face, whether we come back part-time face-to-face, kids have access to that work. And we're not having to scramble. And I think I learned it for me. I learned a very valuable lesson. I'm not going to do this again next year. I'm not going to be scrambling to figure out what it is that I want students to learn and where I want that information to be. I want to have that stuff already online. And I think that's one of the things I think that's, for me, important. I think the other thing too is that we just need to be, I think, a little bit more more vocal about, even though we're waiting to hear back from the powers that be with this school, how we're going to approach the next school year as teachers, as staff, as administration. I would like to hear a little bit more conversation about, okay, let's talk about what this looks like if we're fully face-to-face. Let's talk about what this looks like if we're hybrid. Let's talk about what this looks like, again, if we are socially distant and we can't go back face-to-face. Because I think that's a valid and a really conversation we probably should have been having, you know, throughout some of this time that we've been off. So I know that conversation is happening. But I also think that we on the ground level need to be having that conversation. I think in terms of how we contact kids, you know, I think we did a great job with contacting kids. I probably would have preferred to have spent my day. So if I know I'm teaching from 8 a.m. to 2:15 p.m., I would have preferred, looking now, just to spend my day contacting all of my kids during my first period. During my first period of time, and just moving through the day, and then having and setting that expectation, even if I just talk with kids for 2 minutes during my first period of time. So I actually it's on the schedule. Hey, we're just going to touch base with you. We're going to touch base with your mom, or finding ways formally to do that. I don't know. I mean, I'm not saying what we're doing is wrong. I'm just saying that's where I'm at. I don't know.
Yeah, what I hear from teachers, what I think I see is that it seems like everybody's teaching style and everybody's personality is lending itself to the way they're doing outreach with kids right now, that there's not a sort of one-size-fits-all kind of approach. And so I think that's actually can be good. I think that people can leverage who they are and the force of their will and those kinds of things. Now, I think this whole conversation about how this comes back, this is a very interesting conversation, and I've got my finger on the pulse of many, many schools across the world right now. And the conversation's something like this: we're not going back to the way it was. We're going to come back in some kind of a combination of how it is now and how it was then, and that we need to be thinking about that latitude. So my question here is, when you think about going paperless, I mean, what kinds of things are we building? Because I'm building guitar lessons, karate lessons, drawing lessons. I've put 200 videos on YouTube since this started. So I'm not playing around. I'm building content just in case that's how it's going to be from now on. But what I think is, if we come back, there's going to be some kids that are sitting in your class and they're going to have headphones on, and they're going to be listening to your lesson you created during COVID-19, and they're going to be happy as a clam because they're on that spectrum and they're triggered easily and they can't do the social thing, and they're learning that way, and you got new ways for kids to learn. And I'm guessing that you're kind of thinking, what are you thinking about designing or creating anybody in here to kind of supplement in case we're doing a hybrid situation? Are you building instruction or learning challenges? Or talk to me a little bit about what are you creating right now?
So a couple of things. One, part of that for me is I have been thinking about having a sister or brother virtual classroom with another teacher outside of Summit, so that kids have, so we can sort of be brother sister classrooms and sort of have mentor mentee relationships virtually, because I think that's really important. And I guess I'm thinking on a couple of different levels. One, because Summit Academy is an alternative school, these students don't have access to maybe going out and doing community service during the school day. Part of that is the type of population that we're dealing with. Part of that is also a resource issue and a time. So resources in terms of money and specifically in terms of time. So when I think about these lessons, I'm thinking about, okay, what lessons can I do face-to-face that would not be hard to do, but also, are these lessons, can I flip these lessons digitally, electronically, to make sure that these students can do the lessons or find something comparable? So I think you were on point there. I am building content in terms of doing videos. I am incorporating opportunities for students to use their different types of learning styles, whether it's if they can write, you can write this. If not, you can record it. You can do a video, because I think that's important. And so part of that too comes, with that comes, how do I do that? How do I convey those instructions? So for me, a video is important. I've taught online on the college level and on the community college level. And what I found is that at least with a lot of students, the assumption is if you have a smartphone, you know how to work technology, and that's not the case.
Yeah, that's
not the case. And so I'm finding out, you know, I found out early that even with students who are, you know, community college, people who are lifelong learners, just breaking it down, just for myself. Like, you know, many times I would tell my dissertation chair, you need to talk to me like I'm a 4-year-old. Like, I cannot talk a dog off a meat truck. So you need to talk to me like I'm 4.
Wait, I cannot talk a dog what?
I cannot talk a dog off a meat truck.
Meat truck?
A meat truck, yeah.
That's brand new. I need to write that down. That's brand new to my...
Yeah, I don't have that ability. And so, you know, I have to, and it takes me a little while to think through that process because one, I have to take myself out of teacher mode or instructor mode and put myself back in the student mode. Look, what do I need? I need step-by-step instructions. I need them in bite-sized morsels, and I need it for it to be easily digestible so I can go back and figure out that stuff. So I can do that, you know, I can sort of self-learn if I have enough stuff there. So for me, that means podcasts, that means videos, that means that I'm narrating and I'm actually, so screencastify, that sort of stuff. That also means I want students to have real-time contact. So whether we are in the classroom face-to-face, I see myself connecting with another teacher or connecting with somebody who's doing something in the community and us having conversations and students. So I see them, me giving them things to sort of direct and facilitate that conversation, whether it's a list of questions and I break those questions down. And so we talk about how we retain information, whether it's writing it down, what have you. Also just some online activities, some online assessments. And figure out how I can do that again in ways that are digestible, where it's not overwhelming for them. And so that's where I'm at. When I talk about being paperless, do I see myself being 100% paperless? Absolutely not. But I am doggone sure going to try and get there.
That's kind of exciting goal, Deb, that I think is like right now. I don't know about the rest of you. Please chime in and tell me. How many of you are working harder now than you were before this started? Anybody?
Mr. Honeycutt, like, I can't speak for nobody else. I came in November. I was working hard then. I feel like I'm working twice. You know, I was working. I don't know. Like, and I feel like even though we're coming to the end of the school year, I feel like I'm still like, I have a ton of loose ends. Because we left literally towards the middle of the third quarter. And the expectation was, at least in my mind, that we were going to come back and students was, were going to have, they were going to have an opportunity to at least make up the work from the third quarter. I don't think any of us anticipated that we were going to be out the entire rest of the school year. And now we have to think about approach to teaching, right, approach to managing social interaction. And for me, it's also approach to making sure they get the information so that they can pass. And let me take it a step further. Making sure that they pass and that they realize that we're building towards graduation and then moving towards community being a community contributor, because that's where I'm at with, so I don't want them to just walk out of my classroom and pass. So, you know, the other thing is that I want to be intentional about making sure I connect with other teachers, because I want some of my lessons to parallel or at least overlap with some of the concepts, because I want them to pass the state exam. So I'm trying to be conscious of that, because I want them to hear the same things. I want them to hear the Harlem Renaissance in art, and I want them to hear, you know, if they're working on, I don't know, if they're working on abstract art, I want them to understand that abstract art has a place in society when we're talking about diversity. It has a place in history. So I want to make sure that some of those concepts that they're covering other classes overlap in whatever class it is that I'm teaching, because I want them to understand that it's all connected. Again, I'm probably biting off more than I can chew, but. No,
listen, I love your the level of your goals. I think that we could all, I know a lot of people, and I know a lot of great people who do a lot of training, do a lot of teaching. And I see them being remarkably silent right now. And I'm like, wait a minute. Man, this is the time when leaders and teachers and role models need to not be co-victims and quiet little participants. We got to be leading. We got to be talking. We got to have lofty goals and inspire other people to have lofty goals. Because on the other side of this, everyone's going to remember. They're going to respect based on what we did when we didn't know for sure. That's a faith thing, right? That's a confidence thing. That's a role model level thing. I was going to ask you, Kayla, you're listening to Deb talking about this, and I saw your mic go off, and I thought she's got some stuff. Share a little bit about what you're thinking, what you're doing.
So I had to turn my mic off because my mom was talking loudly in the other room, and she's working from home too now. What I've been working on myself is just trying to put everything into my Google Classroom, and then as I'm doing these packets and stuff, I'm trying to find videos and stuff that I think that would be good material for them to watch if they have access to the internet. Now I've been blindly thinking about next year as us just having person-to-person contact. I haven't been really thinking about us going digitally as much, and I think I also need to think about that more. I mean, I have a ton of ideas. I'm scrambled right now and don't know where to even start. And I don't even feel like a teacher yet because I'm not fully licensed. And I know that also can't be helped right now because they shut down the testing sites for license. But yeah, that's where I'm at right now. Sorry. Oh, you're on mute or something.
You people are my tribe. I've looked forward to this one. I hate to say it, but I got, this is my group right here. So I wait all week just for this little meeting. So I just want to share with you. I'm with you, elbow to elbow. So I'm creating instruction that I make myself, and I'm rethinking my curriculum. You said it, Deborah, bite-sized chunks. Like, I always do this, like, try to give away the whole movie in one shot. No one's going to watch my movie. I got to make them small little bite-sized chunks of do curriculum. Do this. Take a video of yourself playing percussion on something in the house. Find a can, find something that makes a cool sound. And just, I want you to keep maybe a couple little things, like keep even time, like a metronome.
tap your foot with it, right? So you're trying to teach one little concept, right? Tempo or something, whatever that little tiny thing is. And then some way for kids to hand it back into you. Now, this isn't going to work every time. We might, but I'll tell you this, we need to capture as many instances of proof that kids did as we can, because on the other side of this, people are going to say, yeah, show me that kids learned during this time. And you're going to say, either going to have a bunch of stuff or you're going to have nothing. So when people, when kids are doing artwork and giving it back to you, Kayla, rock on, rock on. That's awesome. It's a little harder with the performance, like music or showing an athletic technique or working out, a journal of some kind. How do we get kids to want to do that? Because we're fighting against a lot right now. Everyone, the reality's in their houses. Who even knows what they're dealing with on a daily basis? So if you're getting anything back, number one, I'm happy. Number two, I want you to document that. Put that in the folder. You don't have to curate it right now. Just throw it in the folder, throw it in the folder, throw it in the, at some point, we're going to have a trophy case for the stuff that happened. It's going to be heroic examples that maybe bring us together as a community on the other side of all this mess. So I wanted to let you jump in here, Mr. Rogers, and talk a little bit about what you're putting out there, what you're building. What are you attempting to do right now? Talk to us a little bit.
So what I've been doing now, I've been trying to get on a, because I start, my first day was in January. So I'm trying to like get a schedule, well, a syllabus set up for next year. So I'm working on that. And I also was, speaking in the now, I'm putting workouts on Google Classroom for the students to do. And I'm also, we all have like meeting hours for the students. So I have going on, I have the Zoom meetings whenever like a student has a question or they just want to talk to me. Google Classroom, they can reach me through that way. And working on a syllabus, that's pretty much my school day right now. You're muted, sir.
If I was your student and you were doing a Zoom workout where you're working out, and I'm in that meeting, I'd feel guilty if I wasn't working out with you.
If you were working out with me.
Yeah. So like you do sit-ups or push-ups, whatever you're doing. At first I go, oh, man, look at him. He is working his butt off. First, you're all in, right? You're all in. Yeah. And so there are some students that would be like, oh, they would do it just because you're in. You know, that's what always works. When you're already committed, it's hard not to be. And if you click record, those are all lessons kids can go back and do again next year even. You got a kid over there, you know, whatever, not participating with the group. They could be participating with what you've been. So I would not do a single Zoom thing that you weren't considering recording, because I want it more than once. If I'm teaching it, a lot of times I think I'm going to teach this lesson one more time. And after that, it's going to be archived. That's kind of what Deb was saying. I'm going to archive this stuff, paperless. Yeah, don't waste anything. If you do anything and it's not recorded, it just evaporated after it was. Maybe there were three kids in that meeting. There should have been 20. The other 17 can never see that because it was record. Even if you throw it away, record. I think that's important. There's a couple of things I wanted to show you all that I'm trying to do. Please understand, I don't think I know anything, but there's some stuff I'm trying to do. I wanted to share a couple of those things with you. I'm just going to jump all over the place here a little bit, okay? I'm going to click screen share. And then if it's too much, again, just click escape and then your whole screen won't be taken up by this, okay? So let me know if you can see kind of a bunch of cars. See a bunch of cars? Anyone?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, here's the idea here. I'm just going to, these are crazy things I'm trying. I thought, well, how could we like let kids reinforce that kids are doing things? So on this page here, this is a Google Draw document. I could put kids' names over here, right? And then they pick, like, that's number one. So I go find car number one. I put it in the race. Here's the car right here. If I hit, now, by the way, I'm going to hit share real here because I want you all to play with this a little bit, okay? Get link, can view. No, I'm going to go change to anyone can. I got you. Not view. Viewer, let's go to editor. Okay, cool. Now I'm going to drop you this. Now, gotta be a little careful. Let's go editor, copy link. I'm going to drop that in the chat window. If I can find it here because everything's everywhere. Here you go, chat window. Okay, there it is. Now, if you go to that link that I just dropped you, you'll be on this page. And then what you can do is click on a car, like say car number 5. And you can hit the right button. Here's left, right, up, and down on your keyboard. I can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I can say, hey, Rodney, you did a great job. You had in some homework. Now, the kids only get a view option on this page. They can't mess with anything. But we can't. So you can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and the first kid that gets to that first line gets that first little tiny trophy, but it's something. It's something. And I know this is crazy, but I use this in my art room with my hard-to-reach kids, and they liked, you know, that their car was going ahead. By the way, when they messed up, I could take the car backwards. And they'd say, oh my God, what do I need to do? You need to hand in some homework. I'm sorry, but your car's drifted. And the first one at the finish line. So I stretched this out over 9 weeks. Nobody hit the finish line until 9 weeks. And there'd be a cookie party or something, something that they perceived as a reward at the end of this thing, right? The fun part of this is my five-year-old likes to get on here, click on a car, and have a race with that. So like if we all pick the car right now, let's go back and everyone click a car. I'm going to pick car number 5. You guys pick a car and click on it. And get ready to hit your right button. And then we're just going to hold that right button down and have a little race down the track here. So I'm going to see if any of you click a car. And when I say go, we're going to head on down the track. Okay, so let's see if you do it. Are you marked? Get set. Go. Anybody? I got nobody clicking a car. Woo! So I'm just going to go for it. There we go. That's one thing. This is, I thought, how in the world can we get kids? There you go, number 3. Who's driving number 3 right there? Okay, number 3 stop. There it goes. This is one thing I'm showing you. I got a couple more things I want to show you.
I'm driving number 3.
Okay. Now I'm going to show you another thing. You guys can play back there if you want to. I'm just trying to create a reward model of some kind. What you're seeing right now is what I'm playing with right now, where I can create – this is a Google Draw document. I went around my house, and I took pictures of all these objects. And I took them in front of a green pillowcase or a blue pillowcase. And that way I could remove the background and turn them into objects. Now I'm gonna click the blank version here because I made a blank version for everybody to use. So here it comes. Now I'm gonna send you all a link to this right now. I just want you to play just a little bit with me. This is the online thing where I can do some stuff with you guys. Let's go copy link over to the chat. Here we go in the chat. Join me if you can. Boom, there it is. There it is. Now I'll wait for y'all to show up here. Done. Okay. Now what you do is you go over on the sides and you click on an object like that paper towel roll. And I click copy and paste. And now I got a second one. I'm going to grab that one and drag it over here onto the landscape here. And I can move it around. I can reposition it, right? And I'm just going to wait here till I get some more people in the room. Okay, and if I need to reshare, do I need to reshare that link? Let me do that. I just want to see that you're there. I want you to see that you're there. Get link, anyone can edit, copy. Again, it might be hard to find the chat window, I don't know. Let's go chat one more time. Click on that. Okay, and if this is taking up your whole, there's, I got one person on there. I want you just to click on anything on the sides, right? Let's say a kid goes in here to my little place and messes it all up. He didn't mean to. She didn't mean to. She moved the whole background like that, right? And I just tell her, hey, if anything goes wrong, click edit, undo, and boom, it's back. Don't worry. But I can always go back to a previous version. There you go. Got some Buzz Lightyear action going on right here, right? So what could this be? Well, this could be an artwork. This could be a sculpture. This could be, you know, what we have is the ability to see kids working and create a place where kids can do things. And by the way, let's say I gave everyone in my class, I made one of these for each kid, right? And I gave them a link. And they went in there and they built something, took a screenshot and sent that to me as evidence of what they had done, right? Now I just want you to look, don't think about this as the Martian colony. I built this way, but right now I'm working on the witch trials. And the witch trials, right? So I'm gonna have all these things that come from the crucible on the sides, and the kids will build a story or a scene from the crucible, take a snapshot and explain to me what the scene is and how they understand that particular chapter of that book. So there's a million ways, right? I'm just hoping you think this, please tell me this is a little bit interesting. Anyone? Hello? Okay, I'm going to stop screen sharing real quick. There we go. Now I got some movement over here. Yeah, I got something going on. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so I spent like 8 hours building this page. I'm not trying to get credit or anything, but I'm working on ways that I can see kids work. And there's another one I wanted to show you when we go into Google Draw, I'm gonna make a new document here, okay? I'm gonna go over to here and click new. Let me screen share this. I gotta share this for the visual art thing, okay? Let's go here and here. All right, now I'm gonna make a new document. I'm gonna click new, and I'm gonna go down to more and make a Google Draw document. Now this is gonna be drawing. I'm gonna call it drawing together. This is food for thought. Together, together. Boom, that's the name of it. Okay, now I'm going to share this link. Restricted, no change, not restricted. Anyone with a link, boom, 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 can view, no, nope, editor, there we go. This is all new, I've never seen this page till today. Copy link, I'm dropping this on you, done. Into the chat. There we go. Please join me in here, and I'm going to tell you what I'm going to do here. I'm going to go over to format and click the line thing and go down here to scribble. Once I click scribble, I can just draw here, and if you're on this page with me, you can draw with me. So love it, Kayla, if you would jump on here and let's just kind of create a composition together, right? We can use that scribble tool. If you've got a touch screen, if it's an iPad or an iPhone, they can draw with their finger or a stylus, right? This could also be math equations, music theory, whatever. You could say, kids, I want you to draw your note here on my line. Maybe you've used lines to pre-build, what's it called, staff. You know, and have the kids draw in there, and then we could walk through it together. But what we have, again, in this case, is shared space, and it's live. So if I'm doing this in Zoom, I'm hitting record, and this whole thing's going to be a lesson after the fact. So anyone that is on this page, please draw me a little. Click on the line over here that says line and drop down to scribble. There you go. And just, I want you to scribble. And you might choose shape. You might choose anything you want to, or you could go in there and look for shapes. Let's go into shapes. Ooh. Equations, callouts, arrows, shapes. Let's go to shapes and just see what else they got. And we could drop things in from the web. We could drop in musical notes, whatever you want. There's a nice little smiley face. There we go. And yes, you can text, of course. So this is another way, right? Another way. We were just talking about this with math teachers because they were thinking, hey, I could break this page up into quadrants, and I could assign a quadrant to a certain student, and they could work on some math things, show your work. I just want you to have your mind way open. Combinations of things like Google Draw is free, but if I combine it with recording features on Zoom, that's a lesson. In fact, I could go in here by myself and teach a whole lesson visually. It's not about, you know, me standing there talking to you. I mean, you're going to hear me. But then if I record that, there you go. You got a recording, put it up on YouTube or wherever you share it, and now kids have it. So thanks for jumping in with me on that one. I got one more thing I want to show you. Over here on your document here, I got down here, there's a thing that says Kevin's Coffee House. I don't know if it's live yet or not. I want you to see this, okay? We're processing the video, so that's okay. But for now, I'm going to go back over here. Let's see here, drawing together, my drive. Let's go to coffee. And I'm dropped this link on you. Please tell your kids about this. This is my coffee house link. Let me grab that link real quick and drop it in your chat. More, there's the chat right here. I've been doing this for 2 weeks. I'm doing it for 6 more weeks at least. These are kids from all over the country that show up. Yay. So anyway, drop it in here one more time. There it is. Now, what kids do we want? Performers will showcase talents like acting, speech, music, art, photography, cooking, writing, poetry, inventions, dance, athletic techniques, martial arts, and more. Tell me something that your kids do to demonstrate and they're in the show. Now, this lady here, Jennifer Miller, is a teacher that I worked with years ago. She's been an online teacher for 13 years, and she's a music teacher. Plays piano well, vocalist, does music lessons, vocal. She's been doing that for a long time, and she's good. She's really good people. So she's my stage manager, because I'm not reinventing the wheel here, right? So she's the one that brings everybody in. So think about this for a minute. If you're having a talent show, let's say, Deb, you're having a talent show, you know, a kid could pop in, do something inappropriate, you know, and make your phone ring, But we bring them in through a little system where they audition, right? They have to fill out a Google form. What are you going to do? Please share a link of you doing this before so I can see what that looks like. So no kid who's coming in to bomb the thing, to do something inappropriate, is going to take the time to do all that pre-work. We do that on purpose. We pre-qualify them to be, you know, good people here. And as they come in, it's their moment, right? But the show starts and I'm screen sharing and she's doing a slideshow. It's opening curtains. And then it's Cassandra, you know, you get all the kids in order. Dance, the first one's dance. The next one is showing their art portfolio, right? So we're showing all their pictures and they're narrating their art portfolio. The next one, the kid is showing how to properly do a certain athletic technique or how to do sit-ups or how to, you know, lift weights or whatever he's doing. The next one is reading a poem. The next one sings a song, right? We do about six acts and then we have a halftime. It's a coffee break. And we play online, Jeopardy. Now, by the way, I have a site that I can share with you if you want it, where you can make Jeopardy into a theme, a music theme, an art theme, a PE or athletic theme. You could build your own custom. And so everyone loves that Jeopardy game. I don't know, it just seems like everybody loves it. So they're answering questions there in the Zoom room. And I broadcast my coffee house to Facebook Live. The last coffee house I did with kids, we had 500 people in the audience. Now, if we'd done that in the school, how many would you have in the audience? We had 500. The first one I did, we had 1,000. So this isn't like less or smaller than what we can do in person, right? So tell me you want this. Tell me you got some kids you would, by the way, Deb, I would like to have you perform in the coffee house. Mr. Rogers, I'd like to have you perform. I think sometimes we have to do it first so the kids go, oh, well, if he can take a chance, maybe I can be in there next week. Again, gonna do this for 6 more weeks. Jump in. So if you click here on that form that you got there, let me share that. I shared it with you. But if you click here, it will take you to the Google form, and you'll fill it out. Jennifer will get that, and she will get you in the show. Okay? And I'm going to drop a link on you to the last show. In fact, it's on your page. If you go to Kevin's Coffee House, as soon as that's done processing, you'll see last week's show. And please watch it, please. I know you got things going on. You don't have to stare right at it. You can do other things, wash dishes, whatever, while it's playing in the background. I want you to hear these student voices. I want you to hear them talking about their art. And I want you to see how the kids lift up the other kids, because that's what we do. We clap. In the Zoom room, everyone claps when the kid is done. Always, always, we have to build a culture that nurtures and supports. So I'm throwing this at you. I want to get a little feedback. I'm going to stop sharing my screen because I got a couple more things I got to get you guys to do before we get all done here today. Any feedback? Am I wasting time with all this stuff that I'm trying to do here? He said, trying to.
So I have something that came to my mind. So, I love all the stuff that you have. So I'm wondering how how we could incentivize, and I'll speak directly for myself, how I can incentivize an electronic incentive. So maybe it's a gift card. I mean, is that a good idea? Is that not a good idea? Should we just be focused on, hey, just make sure your car hits the finish line, or make sure your little artist on the sheet completes the artwork? And I mean, how is that a bad thing? Is that not a bad thing? I just keep thinking about ways to get students engaged. I know when I physically was in a classroom, one of the ways I got students to engage was to talk with them. The other thing was I had treats in that little cabinet, and you know, boy oh boy, people seem to straighten up when they realize, oh, you got some goodies in the cabinet. And so I'm wondering how to convert that ethically, and then without having to go through a lot of red tape with parents and that sort of stuff, where it's not intrusive.
I love a couple of things. One, that you're trying to do that. That's awesome. I think about gamification. You know, when you go through a game, you level up to level 6, then 7, then 8. There's bragging rights to that sort of growth. But like that racetrack I showed you, I could have beside each student's name things they've won that you can only get if I give it to you, because you can't edit that page. So I put that trophy beside yours. Now, by the way, the only way to brag is to take people back to that page, which has kids coming back again and again and again. So I found that, like, online, the idea of a gift or a prize is as powerful as the prize. So in classroom, a Jolly Rancher, it's all that. But online, you know, a picture of a Jolly Rancher, and no one else has one. No one else has one. I'm the first one, and I got 3 of them. 2 watermelons and a lemon. That's crazy, right? Who would care? But they do. They do because it's next to their name, right? There's my name. And look, I got three Jolly Ranchers and nobody else has three. No one has two. Bragging rights. That's something. It's not, it's crazy how things work with kids. You know what I mean? Things you wouldn't think work might work. So it's about trying stuff. So that's, I think there's an online version or equivalent to what you do in class with that cabinet. Anybody else have some ideas or theories about that whole, how do we reward kids and get them to do things? Mr. Rogers and Kayla, Tyrell.
Sorry, I was playing Google Draw.
I just asked because I just asked, one, for this reason. Typically, the physical treat really isn't, for some, it's not a physical treat. It really is an opportunity to meet a need. A physical need. I'm so sorry.
No. This is how it is for everybody right now.
Normally we have playtime around this time while I'm working, but I caught me off guard. So normally when I give something out, it's not because, oh, I'm trying to get them to, part of it is I'm trying to get them to buy in. But the other part of it is, it's to meet, I think about Maslow's hierarchy of things. It really is to meet a need because they may not be able to get it, or they may not have eaten, or maybe they didn't have, you know, maybe they don't have something. And so I walk that tightrope carefully because, you know, and then it's, you know, for some one point we, you know, our class took a brain break and we had a taste test of different dried fruits because students had never had different dried fruits. So we just took a brain break and we did that. I'm thinking, I like the idea of just the idea of, hey, I have these Jolly Ranchers, or I got these gold, you know, these gold cars that are next to my name. But I'm also thinking about the kid who, you know, wants Roblox dollars or something like that. And so I don't know. Like maybe that's too much. Maybe I just need to stay on the ground level for right now and just keep it there.
I used to have a shelf in my room and it had prizes. And these are silly things. Can of green beans. A thing of one of them little, meat sticks. I'm trying to remember. Oh, gosh. Crazy stuff. Some of it was food. Some of it was an old stuffed animal. And it was up there where everyone could see it all the time. And so if a kid won a prize, they could pick from my gallery of prizes. Again, none of it was great, but they love these stupid prizes. I got the green beans. Woo! It became a thing, you know, that they were common green beans. Everyone was aware of the green beans, and therefore it's part of the culture, part of the lore. I got a lot out of that. Now, there's an online version of that. You could have an online, you know, gift room, whatever they go to and say, I'll take, remember anyone ever watched Wheel of Fortune back in the day when you had to pick from their gallery of crap and it was all overpriced? Like, I'll have the His and Hers shave set for 5,000. Thank you, Pat. I'll also have, you know, it was terrible, but you saw the gallery of things you could get. I'll have the Weed Eater for 500. Something like that. I think you could do. I've been giving away some Amazon gift cards. Up to $15. Like, the hard part is if I got 20 kids participating and I got to pick a winner, there's always going to be, everyone else didn't win. It's weird human nature thing, you know? So if it's not real cash, it didn't seem to sting as much. I don't want to give away $100 worth of gift cards for everything that I do. And you talked about ethics. You're right. I would like to be able to give a prize away. I start thinking about what those look like. Hypothetical prizes that still give kids cred, that's one thing. Or online things like a book, you know, are there books I give away? So I'm giving away literacy, not money. You know, think about that. I'm coming from poverty and I know sometimes when I give away money actually causes more problems, you know, because then they want that again, whatever. I don't want to enable anybody or become codependent accidentally with anyone. But if I give a gift, I want to make sure it's well thought out and I'm investing in moving them along in a better direction. I don't know. I think you and I are thinking similar thoughts, Deb, but I'm not sure. Chime in, Tyrell. Chime in, Kayla. And I got to move us to another thing that we're going to do because I got two more things I need you all to do before we get all done with this meeting here. And we've already blown through 1 hour. But on this subject here of reward.
I mean, I've used pretzels in my classroom as an award. I have a big jar of pretzels to motivate them to work on their drawings so they can eat while they're working. Or I'll let them use the Chromebook to listen to music while they're drawing. But some of them at some point take advantage of it. Mm. And then I just did away with it. But yeah.
It may sound awful, but I give them bottles of water. So we have a teacher who gives out like those water, those single water flavors to the students. Well, you can't really use them if you don't have a bottle of water. So I saw that students like carried those things around. So I just started buying cases of water for the students. And if you performed good, or like you didn't have any like outbursts throughout the day, you earned a bottle of water.
I like it. I like it. It's simple. It's
right. I get 40 bottles for $3.
It's sustainable. You add that flavor. I know my grandma, my mother-in-law loves Crystal Light. She's 85, got dementia, diabetes. She loves her some Crystal Light. She will swear to God it's the best thing she ever drank in her life. So it's cheap to buy 3 boxes of Crystal Light packets. Yeah, that don't cost very much. Yeah. I wish we had an online version of some of this stuff. I wanted to show you one thing, Deb, real quick. I'm doing lots of stuff with art, and if I can do anything, Kayla, let's say you say, Kevin, can we collaborate? Can we build a Google Draw thing designed to let kids do abstract art collage? Collage is easy because you just put shapes. You can put shapes and forms on there, kind of build up a page, take a screenshot, and that's third hour. Look at third hour's artwork. It's amazing. Okay, fourth hour. I don't see anything yet. Let's see what you guys can do. And again, taking screenshots and putting the evidence into a trophy case or a display case so they feel like, you know, that's a good thing about the coffee house, Deb, is that, and Tyrell, if any kid presents in there, it's on the YouTube video. And it's still available to see again and again. And I can go to YouTube to that part where your kid just started showing that thing he does. And I can save it from there. So when I share that link out to families, it starts with his work. I could do that for each kid if I wanted to. It's about showcasing the work. I want to do a little screen share real quick and show you, Deb, what I've been working on as a proof of concept. Okay, so this is GarageBand, and I don't know what you use. You can chime in and tell me when you're assembling music. But let me know that you can see this sort of timeline up here on the screen. Can you see it? Anybody? You see my composition place?
Yes. Okay,
this is GarageBand, but there are lots of tools. Audacity, you know, there's other stuff out there. What I did is I sent a vocal track to this lady. And I said, just put on headphones, you know, and listen to me. Start singing when I start singing and stop singing when I stop singing. Send me the MP3. And then I'll put them in my software. I'll match them all up and I'll make a song of us together. So she did that. She took me up on this. You don't hear my vocals and my guitar in here yet because she actually outdid me. We worked together on the sheet music on a Google Doc. She kind of broadened my chords because she plays piano very well. I'm playing simple, straight on, you know, major chords, and she's going deeper. So the song suddenly just got better. And she's singing all the parts. I just want you to hear a little bit of this. Because this woman met me on Facebook. I don't even know who she is. She lives in Hawaii. She put in, I don't know how many hours on this. So I thought, man, I could do this with kids. I could make a simple track, click, 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 send that out to kids and say, put on headphones and record yourself playing along with me and send me the thing. So you're still the master producer. When you put it together and they each hear their contribution, you're still putting music together. I'm gonna play a little bit of this so you can kind of hear how it goes. And it's not perfect.
Mother Nature's taking off her crown again. Few more days of warm and then we'll feel the chilly wind. Seasons are living inside us and we feel the summer's end. Times like these, it's good to have a friend. Times like these, you know you've got a friend. Everybody needs a friend, yeah.
This is not perfect, you know. She's a little off time on her tracks, and a metronome comes in handy. And you want the kids to be able to keep that beat. But I can duck that down. I can take that misalignment and turn it down on that track and then bring her back out when she's back in time again. I'm going to sit back here playing with this idea. I've done lots of songs this way because a lot of the performers that I work with, we're not living in the same place. And if we didn't do it this way, we'd never have a song come out. So I just released a song maybe a week ago on iTunes and all the other music players. So I'm trying to show I'm doing this. You might not like my song. Where's yours? Yeah, you can be quiet then because I'm producing. But this is going to come out, and I'm going to blog about how this works. She was sending me screenshots. This was all weird. We did a lot of stuff on Zoom. We didn't agree on everything. She did some stuff with my song that I was like, it bothered me at first, and now I think it's actually better. But anyway, this kind of thing, right? So if we gave an assignment to the kids and said, add your piece to this. I don't care if it's rap. I don't know, vocalizing, scat, percussion, whatever you got. And let's put this together and play it and see what it sounds like. And maybe you have a performance night where you bring that out and all the kids are wondering, wow, I wonder what it sounds like when she put it all together. Anyway, tell me this is interesting. Deb, I didn't waste your time just now, and I'll stop screen sharing this here.
I like.
Cool. All right, I'm gonna go back to that first doc that is for you guys, and I see that you're on there, but I'll make sure we're all on there. I'm gonna grab that link again and drop it in the chat just to make sure. Okay, a couple things I need from you. This is, a little bit of selfish need here. If you look on this page, you'll see at the top it says, here's the video of this meeting. That will be there as soon as I'm done, okay, at the top there. So if you're on the Art, Gym, and Music Tools and Resources page, okay? If you click the Reaching Hard to Reach Kids, that's that page where we're sharing strategies on how to reach those kids we haven't reached. What I need you to see now is fill out the Google form. What I'm thinking about building and developing, we've already talked about it, and it's awesome, to help kids both now and if and when we return to school. There's a form I need you to fill out. And what happens there, if you click on that form down there, fill out the form, you'll be on the Google form. And it's going to ask you the questions below. So don't answer the questions on this page, but those are the questions that will be asked. So what am I doing and what am I going to do to move these plans into concrete action? So what do you have in mind? What are you doing? Maybe you say, I'm going to start recording lessons, bite-sized chunks of learning for the kids that they can use next year too. How will I know if my plans are working? I'm starting to accumulate videos. I've got 20 so far. How will I know? What can Kevin do to help me? This is very selfishly for me. I need to know, Kevin can help me find some resources for this. Can Kevin find some software for that? A web-based music production tool that every kid could use on a Chromebook, whatever that is. What resources will I need to be successful? What can admin or leadership do to help me? This is important, I think. And how can I involve or will I involve families in my planning? I hate if we take off and start building a bunch of stuff that families don't necessarily want. So if we could talk to them and get their input, we could build maybe what they want. Once we have you done with this, all right, and I'd love that if you could finish this today sometime. This won't take long, I promise. Then we'll have a spreadsheet of all the teachers, and we'll see what your goals are. And what we can do is start to say, oh my gosh, you know, this teacher has a similar goal to this teacher. Maybe they can work together. We can start to see ways to support you, number one, and ways to let you work together, number two. So that's the first thing. But what I want to do right now, go ahead and look at that, bookmark that so you can fill that out after this is over sometime today. But down here, a little farther down, it says part two. We'll want to design our and this is the family night, but not ELA, this is art. Let me go in here and change that a little bit. It's going to be art. Art, music, sorry, and PE, family night. But first I wanted to ask you about this. What have you done before with family nights? And I know you all weren't there when we did the last one, but has anyone in here been there for a family night from your departments?
Go ahead.
What just happened?
I was just gonna say Kayla was there for the paint and sip if she wanted to speak about that.
Yeah, I heard good things. Go ahead, Kayla.
I don't know what to say about it really. I'm sorry. But I'm a nervous speaker. I don't know what to say about it. I felt it was successful. I mean, I got all the parents and even some of the students involved. It was my first time doing anything like that. I felt very accomplished doing it, although the painting I used for it disappeared somewhere. So I guess one of the kids must have loved it so much that they wanted to hang it up at home.
Cool. Well, if you do me a favor, if you'll click on...
I was just about to ask if I can go use the restroom real quick and come back.
Yes, when she said I see. Listen, if you all click on the Let's Design Our Art, Music, and PE Family Night, click on that and open up that Google Draw document. And what I've done here is I've attempted to draw your auditorium or your gymnasium or whatever it is. So I've got the doors there. You got the tables across the top and the stage on there. And so here's what I want to do. First of all, look at the goals. The other teachers have kind of established what is the family night about: building relationships, helping parents know we care, demystifying our roles, insight into kids' life. When you see their families and you meet their dad and mom, I just did one of these out in rural Montana a couple months ago. And man, a lot of the parents who showed up, man, I had parents show up drunk, show up stoned. And it really let me know the lives that my kids had. And it changes the way you think. I mean, sometimes it gives you more empathy as you realize what they're dealing with. The school's like one thing they think about. So anyway, there's the goals over there. But over here on the side, on the left side, this event will include, please help me there. This event will include what? An art show, a music showcase, a karaoke event, whatever. You write something there. Kids will. Create a performance to do with the family night. Parents will watch the kids and give them feedback or whatever you decide. Okay, but I need you. I can't fill that part out. That's got to be you guys over there. So art will be on display in the following ways. Music will be on display in the following ways. PE will be on display. We know about 100 people, 80 to 100 people probably will come to this. We'll feed them, of course. So there's the food element, which brings people. And then the other thing, since we're all creative here, a lot of us are creative, right? Should the food have a theme? Should we go to Pinterest and put in, music themes in food and look and see what we could do? And I don't want to spend a lot of money, but there may be a way to tie in the dinner with supporting the curriculum. Maybe up to you. Some people did, some people didn't. It's up to you. A couple of things I need on the page here. That list of work list, I need people to jump in and help me out there. So like, who wants to help out with planning that dinner? Who will put their name on there, actually dare to do that and say, I will help. PR, advertising, one of the things people say is, it's well attended if we get the word out in advance and enough time, parents show up. So we probably need somebody who's gonna make that their thing. And it might be a natural thing to say that's Kayla or the visual arts people. I will help with that if you want. That's my kind of vibe. A couple of things here, and I got social studies on that fourth thing there. We can write other things there. What are some of the things that we need to do to get this thing off the ground? Over here, things we could do. I just wrote some stuff in there. Talent show, demonstrations, games. No, what do you picture? And yesterday, it took us a while. We had to think about it for a while to kind of come up with what we wanted to do with ELA and social studies. But they came up with a great idea that they could all get behind. So this is our chance to kind of talk this through a little bit. You know, that big room with all of our kids doing our stuff, what does that room look like? So let's just chat about that a little bit. We got 2 hours, about two and a half maybe. So they're going to eat for some of that. Probably have about an hour of good time that things could be going on. And then I always try to save some time to clean it up. 30 minutes at the end, everyone helps while the parents are there, the kids are there. They put it all away and it's like it never happened. A couple of times I forgot to do that and I end up having to clean the whole thing up. And there's a lot out. So anyway, talk a little bit. I'm going to unmute everybody so I can hear you. Ooh. It just helped me know that my mic is still working by anyone saying anything. I know you're looking at the page and there's a lot going on.
Okay, so I just came back. What are we on?
We're on this page here, the family night, the planning for family night. I'm going to go ahead and grab that so that and put it in the chat so that you're on that page too. It's linked to that main page that we're on, but I'm just going to give it to you again, Kayla.
Okay.
So for me, I'm doing my coffee houses already. So if I was a music teacher and I had a family night coming up, all those kids I'm working with online doing the Zoom coffee house, I'd just bring those acts to the room and have a stage. So maybe over in the corner, I got a show going on and, you know, some of it's karaoke, some of it's kids singing songs they wrote. Some of it's kids forming bands, maybe just doing a percussion demonstration, whatever. But there's constantly, there's another show, and I'm trying to get all the kids on the stage during this event. That's what I would do. As a visual art teacher, it might be kids doing portfolio reviews, showing their artwork, you know, to an audience. It might look like that. For PE, I would say athletic demonstrations, you know, maybe the kids are teaching you. I come back to this all the time. There's a lot of kids who shoot the ball wrong. I mean, they got both hands on there. There's no balance, so the shot goes left and right. You know, there's no control. But any technique that you would teach, kids could be the teachers of that technique. That could be going on. And maybe over in the corner, there's a game going on that the kids are letting other people participate in, little brothers, little sisters, and they're all playing a game. What is that little game where you're like, you bounce the ball inside the square? What am I thinking there?
Four square?
Oh, yeah.
No, it's like you have to bounce the ball, and you, the little wall around you is like 2 feet high.
Oh, we have that at my kid's school. It's outside.
Gaga
ball.
Yeah. So, like, yeah. Let's say you had that set up, and you were just running people through that, an awareness level, and maybe there's a fitness thing, maybe there's a card they pick up and they read while they're waiting for their turn, you know. And we also talked about in some of these, maybe there's a bingo card. And as they make their way around the room and parents try on and observe things, they get the mark off the bingo card. And everyone that's got a full card at the end of the night is in the drawing for a couple of prizes. Nothing big, but, you know, a couple of little prizes. What can we do to kind of make sure everyone really got a sense of these three different curriculums? But it was fun and interactive. And this is your chance. You're inventing this. This is yours. I hope I get to be there when you do this, but it's yours. Over on the side, I got Kevin's links. There's some things over there. Some of it might be nothing for what you're planning on doing. I just thought I'd throw some stuff in there, like themed Jeopardy. You can go in there and build a theme. Maybe there's a Jeopardy game going on all night too that has the themes of music and art and PE built into it, and we just keep playing that game. Again, big room, right? So what do you want that to look like? So I want to get rid of all the things I wrote in there, like talent show, demonstrations, and games, because this needs to be your list over here. But jump in. Let's talk it through a little bit.
So I was just going back to the art gallery idea. I was thinking they might just want to have a page to add their own images of their own artwork. I don't know if that's a good idea or not.
Yeah, you know, if you did that and you projected it on the wall, we could go from online design to in the room presentation. I like that. It works two ways at the same time. And maybe kids are narrating. This is what I see in my coffee houses. I drew this picture of a squirrel. I like squirrels. This squirrel is very fluffy. I didn't know if I should make it brown, red, or gray. So I made it a combination of, it's just beautiful. Listen to kids talk about their work. So that's cool because they're presenting and they're showing off their stuff. So, you know, maybe we could have a little art auction and the kids could make like limited edition prints, you know, copies of their work and sign them and sell those as a fundraiser or whatever. Just throwing ideas out there. Love the whole game fitness monopoly. Loving it. Loving it.
Trying
and what's
to
music? What's music look like this night?
How do you?
So a couple of things. So I really want to make sure I want to make sure I sort of integrate stuff from other disciplines. So I'm sort of thinking about different monthly themes. So March was Women's History Month. So right before the shutdown, we were talking specifically about women who were composers, women who were directors and writers and singers across the globe. And so maybe that is, we choose, you know, a specific theme for that month that we find, let people find their favorite artist, whatever that theme, you know, whatever that artist, that theme is for that, those artists, and they find a favorite song and they perform a favorite song. They give specific facts. Maybe we find some specific information where they can reenact that stuff and incorporate sort of like a mini musical from their perspective. And that, you know, record that. I really, and then again, reinforcing other concepts that are related to that from English, from social studies. I don't know, this whole edutainment thing is sort of making its something that I'm really interested in, because I want them to be entertained, but I also want that information to stick.
Yeah. I think edutainment, the entertainment part is permission to teach. And then, you know, the stuff that you share is the teaching, is the content. But I think these days, especially, you have to earn people's attention, and you got to pay, you got to make payments on that to keep it. So yeah, whatever you do, whether that's the kids get to invent something to show, now they're excited, a little bit nervous in a good way, right? And I want to make sure we capture all of this stuff too, so there's a kind of trophy case after the fact, because you'll get some parents show up, some kids show up. If they can see how great it was last time, like the coffee houses, for instance, the first one, like I got like 6 performers. The second one, I got 10. I fully expect that after a few weeks, I'm going to have 30, and I'm going to have to go to 3 hours instead of 2. To make the thing work. So I'm learning that showing what we did last time is what's bringing more people to the table to learn. Please, though, over there in things we could do, what I'm thinking is that the more you guys write in there, the more you people write in there, the more we start to say, oh, you know what we could do? We could combine that. So the art gallery has music in the background, and the music is created by kids or curated by kids. And we do that too in our coffee houses, is that's the kids doing their portfolio. There's music in the background. That can be a synergy, which could be cool. How do we add music to the fitness piece, to the PE piece? Of course, right? Any dance that's aerobic, you know, is going to be exercise too. So maybe there's, chime in there, y'all, and just talk. I know we don't have a giant room of people here, but I want to talk out loud and listen to you guys kind of work it out. And you can see down at the bottom is a timeline, plan done by August 1st. That doesn't mean that the whole thing's built by August 1st, but there's a concrete plan. We know what we're going to do. The pressure's off. If school starts, you know, we have to choose our dates, and we don't have dates yet. And you might think about that too, is when would be good for your night. If school doesn't start on time, the plan's ready. Whenever it does, we're ready to move forward. So a couple things, the work list, who can help us with stuff that we need to collect and stuff we need to do. Jump on there and help me flesh that out. And two, flag line, love it. That's so popular. I love what you've done with that. But let's fill up that things we could do so we can start getting a solid plan started anyway, a sketch. I would love to turn all your mics on and have us all thinking out loud. Talk about games and fitness monopoly. What is that, Tyrell?
All right, so it's basically like Monopoly, but you're not buying properties. So I would put spacers on the floor, and say you roll a 6 on a giant blow-up dice, you would move 6 spaces, and that 6 space would either have a workout for you to do, like maybe like 10 squats or 5 jumping jacks, and then it would be the next person's turn.
Like it. Have you done this before in PE class?
When I was still at YSU, we did clinics twice a year, and that was always something that we did.
I could see an artist studio where people watched while, and then you're probably thinking this already, I don't know who wrote skill demonstrations, but that could be in any one of your 3 subjects. It could be kids showing off what they do in music class. Kind of like a talent show, but low stakes, more like, here's how I learned how to play, you know, this song or whatever. Student art Chinese auction. Yeah, let's keep writing in there. What are you thinking, Deb, for this night here?
I'm still thinking. I'm still thinking. So one of the things that came across my mind was finding ways to connect music, sort of an interdisciplinary thing, with what's happening with culture, and having students highlight that stuff. So again, it's probably more thematic, but to broaden it out. So maybe have them talk about hip hop culture, what's happening in hip hop culture, and then highlight different artists and talk about why that music was important. Maybe perform a few pieces. I would have to vet that music, of course. The other thing is, I'm really interested in utilizing music as an action piece. So how can music be active, not just for listening, but, you know, what messages can we send to get people to listen to us, whether it's about political, a political statement, whether it's about getting people's needs, highlighting people's needs that need to be met in the community. And then I think the other thing is that, you know, I really want students to take this to the next level. So even if it's not with music, but with other areas of academics, I really want them to build a portfolio, because I would like to see them move towards maybe looking at a program outside of these family nights where they can say, I did this. So I did this in the classroom. I did this, you know, for our family nights I performed. And maybe having people who can sort of watch them perform, say, you have potential, come and spend the summer or a week of your free time with us. So I don't know if that's answering your question. I need to, like, break that down. I don't know why I'm just so, like, big picture.
No, it's good. I was thinking, how could you prompt some of this association between cultural events and music? But if you had a kind of a game, let's say a game show, and you talked about Vietnam, or you talked about equal rights, you talked about whatever, this parents would have a chance that they would know the music that came along during Motown, whatever it was. And then if you had some questions that prompt current music, you know, so what was Brianna trying to say, you know, or what was, it'd be fun to sit out and puzzle out how you could associate cultural movements and phenomenon with the music that went with it. Because we all know there's a soundtrack to life. Right. If I play a certain song, boom, you're back at Woodstock, or it was Jimmy. It was whatever. Janis Joplin. You know what I mean? There's a lot of cool things you could do there. So I'm thinking about, well, how does that manifest in this room this night? And I'm thinking performance where there's an audience and there's people, like, you know, having to think things out in real time. Man, I like how you're kind of going broad like this and trying to plug your stuff into everything else. Now, if we had a night where every teacher is working together, I'd love it if everything cross-correlated, but I do think with this night, well, you got movement here, you've got visual art, and you got music. These things go together really well. I'd love to see you all sort of make it gel as much as you could. I don't want you to have to work harder, but at least thinking about how that might look. Again, I'm throwing this at you, like, you know, flat-footed, boom, here it is. So I, you know, but I want you to please link, bookmark this page, and come back to it and just keep adding stuff, okay? And what I want to do is distill down the things we could do into what we're going to do, all right? And that became, for social studies and ELA, that became conspiracy theories. What they want to do is have a bunch of activities that sort of take apart what a conspiracy theory is, have kids thinking critically about, how do we know if something's real or it's just sort of made up, you know? And this time in particular, we all know misinformation can kill you right now. So it's kind of back in vogue to think about, how do you critically, you know, get kids to, without touching it directly, how do you get kids and parents to think about this idea of, maybe we should vet things, maybe we should do a little research before we believe things, don't, you know, inject Clorox before you do a little research, you know? That sounds crazy, but they kind of fell in love with that concept, and it became the package that held everything that's happening in the room. So if we had a concept, let's say performance or doing or physical movement or whatever, and it happened across the board, you know, maybe running through art stations and trying abstract art, and then the kid runs over and he tries ink, mm-hmm. and then whatever, and kind of move through there, and now you're over there playing Monopoly with Mr. Rogers, and then, you know, maybe it's one big room in a circuit that we're doing. I don't know. Just talking. Alcohol, ink, paint night. I have thought about buying small tiles for families to create coast. Nice. Nice. I like it because they walk away with something, right? Mm. A keepsake. Flagline. So who does flagline?
Jagan and Viers.
Mm-hmm. It certainly fits in this whole night, you know. This is one more thing, Kayla. You got great ideas, and you're going to come up with a million great things, and you can pick the one you want to do. But if we had a Google Draw, and it was projected on the wall, and kids could come up to 10 Chromebooks and contribute to that Google Draw. And at the end of the night, you could print that off and give everyone a copy that wants one. So the combined community-based artwork walked out the door in the hands of people. So basically you showed, look, we can work together, we can collaborate, we can create something, and we could all take it with us. Something like that for music might be interesting too, is having people contribute to one piece of music that's gonna live beyond the evening. Again, just throwing ideas on the wall, see if anything sticks. Talking about food, what about painting with food? I love that whole painting with food and coffee.
Make you hungrier, but.
I'm gonna make this a little bigger. Now we have those tables that probably won't be able to come out of the room. So you might think of the tables as resources. Of course, people can sit down and create artwork with the tables. But again, they're probably gonna be in the room. Which parts of the room do you want your stuff to happen in? How do we arrange this? The math and science teachers actually drew pictures on the document of what would go where. They got kind of visual that way. We were talking about this grant money. Kristen, there was some grant money. I left this on here because I didn't know how this would
Yeah, that grant money I was talking about, though, is just for ELA.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, if there's anything like that. Okay. I know we were talking about helping pay for the dinner with that, right? All right.
Kevin, I think you're muted or something. We can't hear you.
I'm not talking right now. I just thought I would give you a break. Can you hear me now?
Can anyone else hear him?
Test, 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 test. No?
Yes, I can hear Kevin. I can hear him fine.
I'm not being quiet because I'm not engaged. I just need to, I think this has just been a switch for me, because typically I'm a bottom up thinker, and just since I've been at Summit, I've been a top down thinker. So I just need to flush out the details from the bigger picture to the smaller picture for me, and I'm trying to keep in mind that there are students. So when I've been on Zoom calls, and actually when I've been in Google Classroom and we've done Google Meets, I've had to ask students, so do you mind if I record this? And so I'm trying to be sensitive to how I can do that in a way that is engaging and not intrusive. And then I think you have to know what we're talking about, the buying, right? How can I get the currency, the social currency, the social capital, the investment of getting students to buy in. And so I don't think I'll have trouble getting students to buy in. I just need to flush out those details before I can start talking about this is what this could look like. For me, because I'm an interdisciplinary person, I don't see music as just a standalone. It can be a standalone, but it's a functional, it's for enjoyment. But for me, when I think about music, I think about music being functional. So it's a political statement. It's a cohesive material. It's the backdrop for the main event, or could be the main event, and other things follow music. And so as I'm thinking about these events, I'm thinking about things that the other areas that I could possibly be teaching in, and incorporating music and having students write their own music and incorporate people who are forerunners and people who they think are going to be, the next big thing in their era. And so I just need to think that through a little bit more, because in my mind, theoretically, it makes sense, but in terms of practicality, it does not.
I have an idea. It's probably nothing. I call it memes to music. Like if we said, what were the memes that happened during COVID-19? There was a lot of stuff that comes out that's inspirational, a lot of good stuff. If you had them all printed off and kids had to sit there and kind of put them together and create lyrics from individual memes, and a chorus from that meme, and do a little assembly, right, of cultural phenomenon and cultural sharing that turns into another medium. Again, I want to give you the time to ideate and to think the way you think here too. So look, no pressure at all. I don't confuse you guys, you people cogitating, ruminating with non, what's the word, buy-in or something like that. I get it. we all got different ways of thinking. But I'm thinking, let's keep coming back to this. So two things for the rest of this meeting here. We got about 22 minutes. I want to go back one step. This page needs to be finished out, and I'd like to have a good solid plan in place. It doesn't mean you have to build everything, but at least you all know this is what we're going to do. And you could change your minds on this or that or whatever, but you got a good plan. You feel good about it, almost like your lessons are planned, whatever, for this. And then back on that first doc there, that's our kind of working doc. Don't forget that Google form. And then you could work on this right now. You could say, okay, I'm going to keep thinking about that family night, but right now I'm going to go ahead and fill out that Google form. So I'm talking about one thing that I'm trying to learn and just kind of what's guiding you as you do that and what kinds of supports you would need. And that's really for administrators and the school leaders to be able, and me, to be able to support your journey. And for you to articulate, you know, fully think about, okay, how am I going to move into this thing that I'm going to do? Maybe these lessons that I'm doing for PE or the workout, or the live Zoom workout where I'm going to record a weekly episode or daily or every other day episode. So there's a body of work when we're all done that I can keep using next year. I don't want to waste anything or have you guys build anything that has no utility when school starts. But anything you can make that's online that kids can access, I believe is going to be something that can help us later on. So anyway, I'm going to have you either work on that form or over on the other page, keep working on what that family night looks like. I'm going to leave my speaker on so I can hear everybody and just give you some work time. Are we good with that?
Okay.
Yay.
While you're working, remember when we were drawing on the same page? I could make a video where I'm at the top right and I could say, okay, kids, welcome to the page. Thanks for coming in here. I want you to each pick a spot on the page and draw just a little bit of a something and put your name under that. And we're going to build just a really quick impromptu art gallery here. Now, how you do that is you go to Google Slides. In Google Slides, you can insert a video. So I just make a quick video on YouTube, insert that video, then I copy it, come back to Google Draw and paste, and boom, I just broke the rules and I have a video in Google Draw. You can do the same thing in Google Docs. So if you ever want to put yourself instructing on a page, that's how you kind of do that. I think I'm going to try that right now and rebuild this page here.
Is there some kind of how-to video on how to do that? Like, I'm more visual.
I could make one. I should just do that in Zoom. I could record that and do that right now, since we're recording anyway. Let me see here. if it wouldn't distract people. If I screen share, just click escape so that you can keep working on what you're working on. In the meantime, I'm just going to take a few minutes and actually just do a demo on that. Is that okay?
Yeah. Okay.
So let's go screen share.
I was just going to say, what if they make an inappropriate drawing? Just delete it then.
Yes, and you can always go in there. Hold on, let me see where I found that just now. Version history under the file folder, and click that, and then click see version history, and go back to the version before they did that, and save that, and it's gone. Because some will do stupid things like that, and I'd just say, you know, your kids are your kids. In the room, they would do it. Online, I expect them to do some of it, and part of it is us just going, not freaking out. One thing, my friend Jennifer, who's been doing fine arts online for 13 years, she's got this sort of, she says, you've got to give yourself grace. Got to give yourself grace. That stuff's going to happen, but don't freak out more online than you would in the room, right? But decide what you're going to do when and if that happens. She says it's a teachable moment. She usually, if they're in Zoom, she'll throw the kid off into a breakout room and then meet him in there and say, hey, what's going on? Or she'll meet with the family or call the family afterwards, and not to crucify the child, but it's a teachable moment and say, look, I'm trying to teach in there. What you drew, you know, inappropriate for that conversation. Would you agree, mom and dad? Are you kidding? You know, so she does it. She takes it on like that. And the kid doesn't do it twice. I think you just move forward like, you know, you hope that doesn't happen, but you know what you're going to do if it does. You got your finger on the trigger, got that file button there, that version history thing there, make their thing disappear, you know. Yeah, some of that will happen. I hope not too much, but then I'll go to my share screen now and see here. I'm going to go here. I'm just going to act like I'm working by myself after the meeting's over, the kind of stuff I'm doing all the time. So I'm looking at this now. I'm going to go, I like what I've done here, but I need this to not all be there. I don't want to delete it all. So I'm just going to go file, make a copy. And it's going to be in my drive. Now it's going to be, I'm going to call it Drawing Together 2. Drawing Together 2. And okay, now I got a clean copy. So anytime you got something going on, you want to make, let's say you want to make 10 copies. So each student has their own gallery to draw in. And that way they're not drawing on each other's stuff if you don't want to be, you know, they don't have to be collaborative. Let me get some of this gone. And I got a new, I like my little creature down here, little smiley face. Thank you. I can just drag across all of it and delete it all at once. Boom, gone. Now I'm going to go over to my drive and go new, more, Google Slides. Just going to demo this whole thing, stem to stern. And type. Now you'll see it says file, you can insert, you can scroll down and insert a video. So that's the thing this has that other things don't have. That's why I use Google Slides here. So now I need to make a quick video and put it on YouTube. Let me go ahead and do that too. I'm gonna go, I could do it with my phone real quick, but let's keep it all on the screen. I'm gonna go to photo booth on my side. I don't know if you have something you can just record with like that. Now I'm gonna click video. Okay, now I put my camera on this one so I'm aligned a little better here. Okay, hold on now. Ready? Hi, kids. Welcome to this draw together gallery that I put together so you guys could all draw. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to find a place on the page and just do some simple drawing. Okay, and this is, we're going to use the scribble tool. So look up there. It says line. Okay, click that drop down and click scribble, and you can just freehand and draw. Okay, so you can put shapes together, whatever, but in your quadrant, I want you to, actually it stopped right there for some reason, so I'm gonna go ahead and grab, there's no camera detected, what? I'm gonna grab that video though and show you real quick. Grab it off of here, put it on the desk.
Hi kids, welcome to this draw together gallery that I put together so you can draw. Here's what I want you to do.
Now I'm gonna grab that video and take it over to YouTube. Recent, let's go to YouTube. YouTube, there we go. Now, because that's a short video, it's going to upload really fast. I'll go to my channel, and click on the upload button here, upload video. Go drag and drop that. Now, I could have just done from my phone to here, but anyway, drop it here. I usually call it something once it gets on there. Let's call it Gallery Welcome. You gotta say these days, you gotta say, is this video for kids? Yes, it's made for kids. And there's certain things that won't be possible, which aren't bad things actually. Public, publish. This won't take very long. Then I'm gonna go back into Google Slides. So I'm gonna go close here. 95% processed. Click on this and grab that link. Grab that link. So that's here.
Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to find the person on the page. I'll just do some simple
tools. I'm going to grab the URL at the top.
We're going to use the scribble tool. So look up there.
Jump out of there. Now I'm going to go to this presentation. And I'm going to insert a video from YouTube. Here's the link. Look for it. Oh, there it is. Click on it. Select. Takes a couple of seconds and it's there, right? Now, once it's there, I'm gonna copy it and jump back over to Drawing Together and paste it. Now I can size that. I think I can size it smaller. Yeah, look at that. Size it smaller. And then now when they get to the page, I can add some text and just say click video first. Play the welcome video. Welcome video. And I could assign spaces. Like if I know there's 10 kids, I can make 10 boxes and just let the kids move into the boxes. That way they don't overlap and step on each other. Right. So I'm going to invite you all to this document so you can kind of go in there and play. Let's go restricted. Nope. I'm going to change that to not restricted. Anyone with a link? And I'm going to make you all editors. And copy link. And done. Drop that into your chat window. Okay, please jump over there if you have a minute. And I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna go ahead and click shapes and grab like, I can make a space for each of you to draw like that. Let's say small drawing. Then I'm gonna copy. Right, and now those. Look here, if you make a shape and you click on there's a button, a paint thing that says fill color, you can click on that and you can click transparent. And I believe it will leave you a line, yes, on the outside. So those can be quadrants for kids to draw into. Do that again, transparent. Now I'm just gonna copy paste these everywhere and drag that down. Now, please, if you're on the page, pick a square and click the scribble tool up there under line. I'm gonna make this a little smaller, you don't have to see it. Also, play my video and see if it plays for you.
Okay, I just started messing with Google Draw, just creating a practice mini art gallery. And how do you add frames or scroll down in Google Draw? Do you just add images?
I do, I'll usually, if you wanna scroll down past the given space they give you, I make a shape, like I'll go up there and pick shapes and I'll put it at the bottom and I'll just keep scooting it down. It gets me more and more and more space so that I can get a longer page if I want it bigger. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, it just makes me mad. You should be able to scroll down.
You should. Google is so practical. Sometimes you can tell a mathematical mind designed this space for creating art. So I just look for hacks and ways to break the rules. Sometimes I'll even copy and paste that checkerboard down below and make another one just like it so it just looks like the page is twice as big. Now, if kids are coming in here, a lot of times they'll accidentally do things. Remember, you can always go back to a previous version and fix it. And sometimes I'll do that if they've messed something up. And I try to keep it simple so there's not much they can mess up. I got the tic-tac-toe. I can see the tic-tac-toe board. Okay, I'm going to stop for a minute. But what I like, again, is that we can all work together. I'm going to go ahead and finish out this page and use this for other people too. I've been wanting to do something like this for a while. Now, again, assigning these boxes so each kid has their own box.
Zoom out.
Yeah. And I can make them bigger so it fills the space. So I can make them smaller.
Oh, I see. I can zoom out too.
Yeah. Okay. I'm going to stop recording because I'm assuming we probably got this all. figured out. And again.
Interesting.
Now, yeah, if you could put a video in, think about this. You could actually build a gallery of performance. So kids singing, kids vocalizing, kids tapping out rhythms. If they send you those video links, you can put them all on the page the same way, so that you can just click on play and see every kid's contribution.
I haven't actually made any how-to videos yet. What holds me back is fear. I don't know why.
Don't let it.
I get nervous.
It's easy to say, I know. But I guess one old Jedi talking to a young Jedi. Let me tell you what I think I know. I finally got over worrying about what people think because you know what helped me is I have kids who have anxiety, and I think if I can't demonstrate that I'm fighting, doesn't mean I'm winning, but I'm fighting against my own fear. They won't do it if I can't do it. So I make those videos, and I just remember that the kids need me. They need me. So I've got to try to make those first demonstration videos. And if you just keep it simple, good grief. I know you've seen some of my online stuff. There's a lot of really good artists out there that probably think that my stuff is kind of, what's the word, elementary, trailer park. I'm not really qualified, all kinds. And I give them about 2 seconds of thought and I put that away because they're not sharing online. They're not helping online. They're not me. So like my first drawing lesson I did for elementary here in my little studio, I drew a fish, a very simple fish, a little bit of seaweed, kind of 5 minute lesson, less than 5 minutes that they could do with me and say, I drew a fish, Mom. Yay, I gave you a moment of happiness like that. I gave you a moment of success. And the next one we're going to draw a lobster or a crab or something else underwater. Maybe I do a theme of 5 videos in a row, all underwater things. And the next thing is going to be things that fly. And the next thing is, you know what I mean? And simple, 2 minutes. If it goes wrong, you can make another 2 minute video. I don't want to spend 30 minutes. And if I hate it, I wasted 30 minutes. Mm-hmm. I want to blow through 10 of these things in an hour easily, you know? I'd say start, show me what you've got. I'll back you up and say, way to go. You might need that person that just says, yes, move forward, please. Perfect is the enemy of done. Just start, start. Think of those kids needing it. And keep them short, short, sweet little skill things, you know? Any technique you learned in college that you really loved, that someone showed you that, you know how you show a kid a technique and they like it so much they draw it on everything they have? You look at their notebook and you see it over and over and over. A lot of that 3D stuff is the stuff they like, you know, or point perspective, whatever. Making their name look like it's 3D, you know that stuff.
They like bubble lettering and drawing three-dimensional shapes, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I might start with some stuff like that and just talk while you're drawing. I point my phone at my draw pad. Let me show you. This is some of the stuff. I just keep a sketchbook around that I can point my phone at, and then I have I treated myself to a set of these nice Conte crayon pencils. But I'll have a box sitting here and I'll put my phone on the box, but I'll hang the camera off a little bit.
Okay.
That becomes my document cam. Then right in front of the box, that's my drawing space. Keep it simple, you know? And then as soon as you're done, put it on YouTube. Don't wait around. Don't collect a bunch. Just start putting it on YouTube and until you have a collection. And I get on a piece of paper and I write down the first 5 things I'm going to do. So I draw a fish, you know, draw a squid, draw seaweed, draw a crab, draw, you know, whatever you've decided to do. And then go ahead and just make them real quick. Act like you're teaching your daughter, granddaughter, niece, nephew. Talk like there's a kid in the room drawing with you and they'll be fine. Mm-hmm. I aim for grade school, but high school kids can do it too, and they feel smart. So, and I can give you all my video links if you want. So you can just say, God, if he can do it, I can do it, because mine is not anybody's PhD level stuff. Let me go find, I'm going to go back here, just drop a link. Let's see here before I let y'all go. So goals tonight, sometime getting that Google form done. Please keep contributing to this planning document for our family night. If you have ideas, questions, if you need to call me, and I'm gonna put my number down here in the chat.
I was gonna say, what is the best way to contact you? Do you have an email or?
I get 100 emails an hour. So I lost track of email 100,000 emails ago. The best way to reach me is Facebook or text me. Once I get you in my directory, we can talk more. I'm just putting my number in the chat right now. So keep that. And literally, if you hit me up and said, hey, Kevin, can we meet up? Do you have any time tonight? I just want to walk you through what I'm thinking, and we'll get a Zoom room going, and then you can screen share and show me what you're thinking. And if I can't figure it out, we'll find someone who can.
Okay.
I'm going to go over here and just drop this on you so you have everything. My examples, I'm hoping to make you braver. They won't make you think, I can't do that. Most people say, God, I can do it that well. I'm going to search for LearnFlix. How's it go? LearnFlix. I'm dropping this on you again in the chat window just so you can see. This is what I've been doing. I've been curating all my stuff into one page. So these are video snapshots. So like if I'm teaching you to draw a fluffy bunny, I just scroll through the lesson to where you can see the bunny almost done. And I take a picture of that. I put it on, this is a Google Draw page, by the way. And then a kid can click that and takes them right to my video. They can draw. And then on the sides, I offer them the opportunity, hey kids, share your artwork with me and I'll post them here. Then they send those to me and I do email that way. And I take that picture and put it over here. So I have a ability for them to hand it in, to be showcased. And all this stuff that I do is in one place. If you look at Mr. H's drawing lessons, that looks like a show right there. That's really just me as simple as possible showing you one simple thing, how to draw a fish. And the next one's how to draw an eyeball. I'm going to do how to draw a tree. Stuff that make kids a little bit better and make them proud that they could draw a tree. So anyway.
I also had a question. I have a film photography class next year and we really don't have much for photography. Is there any like good websites to apply for grants and stuff that you know of?
For me, and I just kicked in $89 for this teacher's GoFundMe campaign to buy a document cam for her classroom. I mean, I'm a sucker for a teacher with a dream, but I don't know. Please help me out here. Kimberly, yes. are they allowed to do a GoFundMe or donors choose?
Nobody has since I've been there, but I think as long as Ashley is aware of it, I would make sure you have prior, you know, permission. But other Summit teachers have done them. We just haven't had any from our building do it. So I would say, yeah. And as far as the document cam goes, I'm not sure, Kristen, if those came in, but I know that we did order all of our teachers one of those. So they will have that.
They haven't come yet, but yeah, that was on an order.
So that's a resource that they didn't even know they were getting that we just thought was important. So hopefully they'll all be able to use those.
What I would say, Kayla, is go ahead and make a list of the things you wish you had. Now, I always tell teachers, start with like a $200 and then do another one. If you do a $2,000, let's say you go for all of it in one shot, the number looks so big, a lot of your donors will be chased off by that number. So if you say, I really need $1,000 worth of stuff, Kevin, fine. Let's break that into four pieces, $250 a shot.
It's just like simple materials I wish these kids had were like sketchbooks and portfolios.
Yes. Well, that's perfect. If you'll build a donor's choose or a GoFundMe, and if Ashley needs to know, whoever needs to know, make sure you check in with that. Send me a link and put it on social media. I want to put it on Twitter because we have a shot there, you know, 65,000 followers. If I say help this art teacher get some basic supplies because her kids really deserve it, that's a call to action, right? And we'll see. We'll get that first one funded and we'll just keep going. I help a lot of people with retweets and visibility on their GoFundMe campaigns. I'm a sucker for it. So as soon as you get yours up, I'll be your first donation.
Okay. Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Ain't no thing. All right. Well, we are at the top of the hour, a little bit over. I want to thank everybody for contributing. And can I give you a little push to keep going? That thing that you want to do? I try to do something that scares me at least once a day. Something that I'm not comfortable doing to keep stretching myself. So I want us to come out of this stronger, better, smarter, and more well-equipped than we were when we went into this. Otherwise, Why are we just suffering? You know, why are we wasting time? I'd love to hang out just for a second with Kimberly and Kristen when we're done here and get a little little conversation about tomorrow and just check in with you. But the rest of you, I'll let you loose. Give me a yell. You get my phone number. Shoot me a text.
Thank you very much for your time.
Always, always. Mm-hmm. We're in this together, friends.
Thanks so much. Thank you. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
So Kevin, Ashley called me when we were in the middle of this, and she has a request. We are creating